Just, you know that
process. Respected lecturers, camera person, and the lovely ladies, good afternoon. My name is Anshuman Akash. I'm presenting about cinematography today, the basics of cinematography. So I'll start with the definition first. Cinematography is something that's related to motion pictures, where we record the number of pictures which is moving in seconds. So we have different frame rates to record the same thing. In digital cinematography and computer generated imagery, we have broad changes in cinematography, which has traditionally based on chemical photographic images and effects. Like previously we had stocks, we had films, but now these days we have digital stuff, so we record anything through digital medium, which can be a video camera, a DSLR camera, or a phone, any medium that can record a video. So cinematography has to do everything with the camera, lens, film stock, exposure, and these days it's digital. Right. So composition of the frame and mobile framing. The frame aspect, the frame shape or aspect ratio, camera distance, type of shots, which is close-up, medium shots, angle or height of the tripod or camera.
What is the 180 degree rule in cinematography?
180 is that we have established, if we have, suppose we have a situation, we have to establish a shot, like two of the shots. So we use 180 degrees so that we can establish the distance, like that there's one setup that's happening here, which can be master shot or anything, and that we are connecting it with the other shot. So that's 180 degree angle. While the camera pans from left to
right, talking about panning.
Left to right or right to left? So,
suppose if you want to shoot an interview, one-to-one interview, in news channels, what kind of setup you need? How many cameras you need?
It can be two or three, depending on the kind of shots we need, because we can use one camera, but then we'll just get one perspective from the front. And if we have two cameras, we can use the front camera to get the expressions and moods of the person who is talking in the camera, and we can use the second camera to give an extra effect, which will somehow communicate the sense of the talk, that if it is in trance or we are going in a live mood, it just to give a good feel and about the whole situation. So camera lenses and exposure choices and techniques, which is used to called as photographic elements. Lens types are telephoto lens, wide angle lens, and lens settings are focus, aperture, depth of field.
Please, don't read it, Anna. Try to explain it.
Yeah.
Suppose we are students.
Okay.
Anna, you are in the class. That's why we create this environment. So we don't want to see your PPT. We want to see your expressions and your teaching skills.
So lens types are telephoto lens, lens types can be telephoto, wide angle, and then there we have lens settings, which is focus, aperture, depth of field, and then we have exposure issues. So if we talk about focus, anything that's sharp in the frame is called sharp focus, and focus can shift from foreground to background. And then we have aperture that controls the amount of light that enters through the lens, which gives us depth of field that can be shallow or a great depth of field. So if you talk about great depth of field, that is something when we have everything from foreground to background sharp in focus, which requires higher aperture number, low ops.
Why we use small sometimes in videography, we use shallow depth of field. Mainly in movies. Why?
Because to show the more impact of the person that we are filming in the movie or in the scene, which has something to do with the emotions and kind of the feeling we are supplying through the footage or visuals. And then we have camera angles, which is first Psycho, or which is called Hitchcock. This camera angle is actually a higher camera, a higher angle, which is used to give a feeling that the person who has been filmed in the scene or in the shot has a lower value in the frame. So we use a higher angle of the camera. and then we have straight angle, which is for usually like interviews or when we are taking a normal talking shots of a person walking or if we are tracking someone. So this is the kind of shot we use. And then we have lower camera angle, which is used to show the importance of the person in the frame. If we have something which is greater or which has a greater value, we use low camera angle so that we can give the same sense in the frame. And then we have Dutch angle, known as canted framing, where the entire frame is a bit slanted, which gives a sort of sense where it can be dangerous or anything that's abnormal, not only dangerous, but when we have a sort of confusion or danger, like abnormal situation, we use Dutch angle. And the same thing about Dutch angle. Okay, then we have different kind of types of shots, which is extreme long shot, medium shots, close up, close medium, close up, and extreme close up.
There's one more shot, OSS. You know that shot?
OSS?
Over the shoulder.
Yeah, over the shoulder. Yeah.
What is the use of that shot?
It's basically to show that the person is talking to someone. It's usually for perspective reasons that it will indicate or show that we are talking to someone. We are not just talking blankly right into the camera, but to someone. So extreme close-ups are basically to establish two situations in between. Then long shots is to show the environment, more or less the environment. And then we have medium long shots, that's usually we use while we are tracking or we are chasing someone. Then we have medium shots. So this is the example of shots. So other than those shots, we have establishing shot, master shot, two or three shots, reverse shot or reverse angle shot, and then POV, aka subjective shot that we just talked about. And few films that used the same thing. Then we have aspect ratio. Aspect ratio is basically the ratio between height and the length of the frame, which can be which changed from the time initially we had.
What is the aspect ratio of this computer screen?
This is 16:9. So for when we use 4:3 composition, which is well suited for close-ups, that we don't crop the head or chin if you are taking an extreme close-up shot, which is this one. And when we use 16:9, then we have a longer focal length where we have the environment, but somehow we lose the essence of the shot, that we had that intense movement like in movies of director. Okay. So in his movie, he always puts his subject right in at the center of the frame when he has environment and the person itself. So somehow in his movies, he always try to communicate that style of his shooting first, and then intensity of the movie, that everything is running around this person, so he is always sitting in the center of the frame, which is his style. That depends from director to director. And then we have 16:9 letterbox, where the face has that rule of thirds. Okay. So then we have mobile framing, actual movement of the camera, or zooms where camera doesn't have a movement, but we zoom in to from the foreground to the background, which is somehow used to establish few of the shots. And then we have computer generated shots, which is flying, or like basically we have visual effects, so we create all these kind of effects in the computer. And then we have pans, tilts. So pan is something when the camera moves from left to right or right to left. And then tilt is something where camera rotates from vertical, moves from vertical to horizontal or horizontal to decline. So it's the movement of the camera.
Do you know something about light in cinematography?
Yeah. Okay. But I haven't talked about lighting in this slide.
I'm just asking.
Okay. And then we have dolly or tracking shots or traveling shots. So dolly is basically used to chase an object in the frame when we have the camera moving from left to right or moving towards or moving backwards. and then we track someone, so it's basically called tracking shots. And then we have crane or...
You know how to handle camera?
Yeah, sure. I do my films. Actually, I have a YouTube channel, so I make my travel films. So I don't have a video camera, but I use my DSLR to make all the films because that's more handy. And it's always about the medium. I use my phones if I don't have accessibility. Like I'm traveling somewhere, if I take out my camera and people will look right into me and I want that candid shot, I'll use a phone because medium is more important
and
to convey the story.
What about editing softwares?
I use Adobe Premiere Pro. I use iMovies, but I'm trying to learn FCP, which I'm not really giving great time because I'm busy with few other things. And I'm getting good in Premiere Pro, so I'm just going with that. And then we have handheld or steady shots, which is a newer generation because previously when we had trolleys, we had that problem of slow movement or we could convey the story with trolley and zooming in so to make a shot faster. But now we use handheld or steady cam, which bring down the production cost and it's more handy. I previously talked about these things. Okay, this is the dolly and track that we use. Okay, then we have crane shots or boom or jibs.
So
basically,
if you're being given camera and lighting, would you be comfortable in teaching video camera and lighting both?
Yeah, sure. Because
yeah?
Actually, I taught in School of Cinema for a month and a half.
Okay.
I was teaching to
okay.
Students of semester 6 of bachelor's and semester
okay.
4 of master's. So I'm
okay.
good with camera
okay.
and lighting.
Okay.
So crane shots are basically where the camera is mounted on the top and then we have that 180 sort of thing where we can use that to establish two different sets or just to move the camera on a large scale where we have to move the entire thing. So we use cranes and crane shots are basically for those. And yeah, this is an example of handheld or steady cam.
No problem.
No, actually, the monitor is gone. So, handheld or steady shots are something which is used to track an object on a basis of motion when we have more motion or we have to show the romance in the frame that we are following someone or the intensity of the frame when we have action shot and we are just moving with the camera, so we use steady cam or this sort of camera movement. So
have you yourself used steady cam?
Yeah, I have a steady cam, so I use it.
Okay.
It's an essential part of filmmaking and we always
yes,
have
it's
to
a difficult
get that
thing also
steady
to
shot.
Use a steady cam.
Yeah, it is difficult, but with practice we get better with this. And I don't really have this big one, but I have a smaller version of that, so I can always move around with that. And then, when viewing a film or mobile framing can be hard because we always have that sense of traveling, like traveling in the mobile framing, so we try to keep it simple so that we can convey the same message to the viewer or to the layman. And sometimes it can be tricky because of different kind of equipments that we use for the mobile framing, which contains like shooting with car or shooting with different action shots. So a mobile framing can be difficult at times, but it's always interesting to use mobile framing to get
just wrap it up quickly.
Yeah, it's almost done.
Okay.
Because I've already talked about the Shangri-La and moving right to left, so these are just slides that I thought I'll talk in brief. Yeah, then subjective shots and POV.
Thank you, Anshuman.
Thank you so much.